Updates coming in, that's the wires reporting the growing troubles at Jet Airways. Lessors are raising more and more concern, and they are terminating lease deals. Let's see. The other statement that we got from an SBI official was that a comprehensive plan is indeed being worked out, and they're hoping to reach an agreement in the next couple of days. So, you know, it's right now, it's everything's just up in the air, literally. All right, on that note, let's move on and get you that promised conversation. The theme continues to be elections and the state of the economy. Ahead of that, Lata caught up with Sonal Varma, MD and Chief India Economist at Nomura Financial Advisory Securities, to get Nomura's view on the economy.
We don't think it has troughed out. I think over the last 5 years, two things have happened. I think, you know, when you're looking at growth, we need to look at the trend and the cycles. Okay. Over the last 6-7 years, clearly India has not seen any investment cycle recovery. So that clearly indicates that potential growth actually has been going down. Okay. But within that broad trend of moderating potential, we've seen two cycles, the 2014-15 up cycle, the 2017-18 up cycle. Yeah. Our assessment right now is that cyclically, the economy is clearly slowing down, both because of domestic and global factors, and that this slowdown will continue for at least a couple of more quarters. So to your question, the economy has not yet troughed out cyclically. But I think the bigger challenge, of course, is the more medium-term trend itself, and what we need to do to reverse that trend, because global factors, of course, are not looking very supportive.
That is exactly what you know, the previous episode of this series indicated. Economists worrying that our potential itself is not beyond much beyond 7. Do you worry that it could be as bad? And of course, this is also coinciding with the global growth not picking up.
Absolutely. I think, you know, it's always fuzzy, the assessment of potential growth. But I think the clearest evidence would be when you start seeing signs of inflation. Mm. And if you look back over the last 5-6 years, every time growth has crossed 7% sustainably, you've started to see core inflation picking up. So that would suggest, you know, that potential is probably around 7% right now. Mm. I think the big concern is that globally we seem to be late cycle. Mm. And globally we are moving in an environment towards more protectionism. Mm. So the old growth models that worked, let's say, for China or East Asian countries is not going to work for India at a time where our working age population is actually picking up. Mm. So that means that we need to look internal in terms of maximizing our growth driver. Now, that internal growth could come in via more consumption, which should not leak out into imports. So we need to be producing what we are consuming. Mm. It needs to come back to more infrastructure spending that needs to come in. But I think, you know, what is India's growth model? Mm. What do we need to do to get to that growth model and to sustain that growth model, I think, is a very, very critical question we need to be answering.
Okay. Yeah, of course, that has to be a bipartisan dialogue. No matter which government comes to power, that question has to be answered. But here, do you think one of the problems of the past 5 years, and maybe even earlier, is that savings, household savings is not picking up? Will that, I mean, what's your assessment of the savings rate and its trend going forward?
Well, household savings have, of course, not picked up. Mm. And, you know, I think what it implies is potentially two things. One is that income growth itself has been slowing down. Or for a given income growth, households have been consuming a lot more. And, of course, since we've seen more bank credit towards retail expansion, it would suggest that there's a leverage-driven consumption that is going on. So one of the reasons for the moderation in household savings could be that we are just consuming a lot more, and part of this is leverage-driven consumption. Is this a concern? It is a concern because, you know, ultimately to fund our investment cycle, we need the domestic savings. You cannot solely depend on foreign flows to fund our deficit. At this stage, I think the investment cycle is still quite weak, so you don't need that level of saving. But when we do get that investment cycle pick up, savings need to clearly pick up. So this is one of the constraints that could come to bind us when we look to internally push the growth drivers higher.
Okay. Well, the achievement of the NDA government on inflation is, I mean, the numbers show it was superb. But where are we placed now? Did the last numbers give you any indication that we are troughing out and we should now start worrying that inflation will not be so benign?
Well, you know, at 2% inflation, of course, you know, it's going to move higher. But I think the broader macro drivers of inflation do not suggest something to be too concerned about, because when you look at the core inflation, if there's a cyclical slowdown, if input cost pressures are coming off, globally there's a synchronized slowdown that suggests that price pressures are under check. Similarly, if you look at the food economy, there's excess supply in certain categories. You have global food prices, which are still quite low, rural wages, which are still quite subdued. So this macro factor condition does not suggest that there's going to be a big inflation problem right now. So yeah, it may be troughing out, but nothing to be too concerned about.
Okay, how many rate cuts then would you expect?
Well, we think there will be one for sure, and given the growth inflation environment, our assessment is that the you know, the projections of growth for FY20, which the RBI is projecting at 7.4, are going to surprise on the downside. So we will not be surprised if there's 25 to 50 basis point more from here. But I think more than the rate cut, the challenge now is transmission of the rate cuts, and therefore what needs to be done to enable you know, credit deposit ratios to look much better in terms of maybe more liquidity injection will become a lot more critical.
Well, that clearly brings us to the fiscal deficit issue. One reason why the transmission is not happening is the crowding out of the private investor, private borrower by the government. I mean, do you think even if there is liquidity, there is a limit because the government is too big a borrower?
For the existing saving pool, yes. Are we seeing crowding out of private investment? I think private investments are weak for many, many reasons.
Yes.
It's not just crowding out. And given the debt issues that we are still trying to work our way out, in any case, the first stage of investment is going to be more brownfield investment rather than greenfield. So I would not blame the government for crowding out. But given the fact that we have limited financial savings in the economy, most of which is getting used up by government and government-owned entities, I think we are not building the solid foundation to be able to sustain the investment cycle when it picks up. And therefore, you know, over the last 5 years, the government has focused on macro stability, has focused on correcting, you know, some of the issues, bringing in GST, IBC, etc. So the foundations have been set. The second, the priority going forward has to be how do you kickstart the investment cycle in a world which is closing up. So you need to look internal, get that going. And then there's a stage three of reforms, which is that labor is no longer an advantage in countries because even manufacturing is moving towards more automation. Are you skilling people enough in terms of education, etc., to sustain that much higher? So I think stage two, stage three is where work still needs to be done.
Okay, I am coming to that in a minute. That was going to be my last question. But just before that, do you think the way in which, although fiscal deficit is a big achievement of the last 5 years compared to the previous UPA term where fiscal deficit was averaging over 5%, the last year has seen the you know, a recurring expenditure of about 70 to 75,000 crores purely as farm income transfer. Do you think that will mar both the quantity and quality of fiscal deficit going forward?
Incrementally, yes. But I think this is a political economy question. And, you know, good economics may not always be good politics. And we cannot have a sort of an economy where, you know, 70% of the, you know, economy is suffering in terms of trade negative shock. And therefore, from a purely social, you know, social economy, political economy perspective, the focus on farm incomes, rural redistribution. In fact, our assessment is that irrespective of the government in power over the next 5 years, we will see rural reflationary policies is coming back, because this is going to be a political priority, irrespective of the government in power.
Well, hope it can even kickstart consumption. It may have some positives to it. But let me come to employment. As you pointed out, the hushed up NSSO report indicates that unemployment is at an all-time high, or at least was at an all-time high in the year 2018. You know, how do you see that getting resolved, both in terms of quality and quantity? Is that going to be the biggest problem for the next government?
I think it is a challenge, and it's a challenge worldwide in terms of being able to create, you know, sufficient number of jobs. Now, in India's case, clearly we have skipped the manufacturing stage of development, and, you know, going back to the world that we will get into over the next 10, 20 years, the kind of jobs that will be created, and are we skilling people enough to be able to actually take advantage of those kind of jobs? But essentially, I think, you know, the services sector, you know, more entrepreneurship kind of jobs in the services sector, you know, how do we ensure that the agriculture sector benefits from maybe food processing related kind of jobs, the construction sector, which tends to be more job intensive. So,
you know, since this series is more about the last 5 years, do you think the last 5 years didn't recognize this problem or do anything towards it in terms of skilling or in terms of agri-processing? Was that one of the shortcomings of the last 5 years?
I think if we sort of dial back 5 years, the problems we had back then were very different, Lata. I mean, you know, we had the high inflation, we had the legacy, we have the NPA issues.
Yes.
And I think the last 5 years, we've sort of spent correcting the macro stability and trying to recognize and resolve the NPA issues. So the last 5 years have been more about creating the foundations.
Yeah.
The next 5 years, now, having built the foundation, we need to get to the next leg of growth, which is where, you know, the focus has to be. And, you know, coming back to your previous question on the fiscal side, most fiscal consolidation in India has historically always been via revenue rather than expenditure compression.
Okay.
And therefore, GST has not led to the kind of revenues one had expected, but hopefully post-elections, if we do see better tax compliance and revenues, then it has to be revenue-driven fiscal consolidation. It cannot be purely expenditure-driven fiscal consolidation in India.